Okay. You know, it's taught, we're taught in the scriptures that where there is no vision, the people perish. And the Hebrew word of that, it means a slow, languishing, dying type of thing. Where there is no vision, the people perish. And also it says, for lack of knowledge, my people are destroyed. And it also says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And our deck, may I have some water, please? Is that possible? But thank you. Blessed is the nation. Our Declaration of Independence, the first law of this new republic. You know, there is some wiggle room, I think, in my lay scholarship. I think I've learned is that there may be some wiggle room between separation of church and state in this country, right? But emphatically, the Declaration of Independence points out that there is no separation between God and state for this country, because the central figure of the Declaration of Independence is God. It's God. And of course, the book of Daniel says that God is in the midst of the affairs of governments. So he's there. And I think what has happened to us, we the people, I mean, we claim, we believe that we are a Judeo-Christian society, and we have God's name everywhere, all the scriptures and all that on the walls. But something is wrong. And I believe it's because we have not really communicated with him in these days as we need to communicate with him. And he expects us to communicate with him if we're going to get out of this mess that we're in, that he's kind of arranged for us in one hand. You're all aware of the Black Lives Matter and all this that's going on in the country. And as you know, since our country has been, since 1776, the issue of Black lives mattering has always been an issue in our country. And in these last generation, no matter what happens, if a policeman shoots a black person or there's a movie about roots or something, there's this narrative, that this discussion, this dialogue that begins, and it's always, it's always us black cats talking to you white guys about how racist you are, how you need to reform yourselves. You need to transform. You need to. It's always a one-way lecture from us to you, how you need to. And you know what you've done? I believe in this whole issue of racial divide in our country. I believe, especially since the 1960s, that my white brothers and sisters in this country have come further, much further, towards relating and rectifying with us than we have to you. We have been static. Listen to our rhetoric. The white man is the white man, and no matter what, I stub my toe, it's the white man's fault. It's debilitating to ourselves. We don't even know it. It's been going on for years. And it's gotten so much. I mean, my white brothers and sisters, bless you. You have been this way. You have been that way. This way, that way. Every kind of way to be appeasing to us. To the point that you can't say things. You can't even point out something about us that's correct without being accused of being racist. And bless your hearts, you've gotten white guilt confused with conviction of heart. Guilt brings damnation and death. Conviction brings life. And you've got it confused. Because when Dr. King was assassinated, you had already given us the Civil Rights Act, Civil Rights Act of 1964, you've been going to change and do all these wonderful things. And then when Dr. King was assassinated, see, we black people don't love Dr. King. Is this on video? We black people do not love Dr. King. Never did. Few of us, yes. The majority of us, it wasn't because he was Republican, it was because we could care less about civil rights. We care less about what the man had to say. I mean, we knew the issues, of course. I grew up in Jim Crow Maryland, Jim Crow Alabama, so I've experienced that heat, that fire. But yeah, I wish the man to get off of television. I'm trying to watch a program. He always comes on TV. Well, when he got assassinated, I came home from work. We were all like, man, they got the king, man, they got the king. And I went home and looked and watched on television. And when I saw white people in this country, all across the country, of every kind, the outpouring of grief and concern, the way you cried, I was like, oh, that's Dr. King? And then I began to get interested in Dr. King and the civil rights movement, and then, you know, the rest of the story. We didn't care about Dr. King. To this day, we don't care about Dr. King. And I'll tell you why. Because Stevie Wonder, bless his heart, in the belief that you give black people a national holiday, something that we could be proud of, that we would stand up and we would get our act together and we'd do the right thing. Happy birthday to ya. Happy birthday. All of that. You know something, folks? We have slapped Dr. King in the face. Because I'm in L.A. We have the largest Martin Luther King rally march in the country. Every year, after the rally, little black kids are out there popping caps in each other's butts. Dr. King told us in 1963, now he said, now look, I'm paraphrasing. Now, in a speech, I have a dream. Y'all have read it many times. He said, look, y'all, let me tell y'all something. When you go to judge somebody for good or for bad, to hire or to fire, whatever you're going to do, if you're going to do that, do not do that because of the skin color. Do it based on the content of their character. Let's not do it the white guys did to us now. We should know better than that. We've criticized them, we've yelled at them, and we've been down on them and condemned them. Let's make sure we don't do that, or we're worse. We say we see, we say we know better. So, sure enough, one day this cat shows up in 2008, some dude we ain't never heard about, ain't never seen before, some cat they call Barack Hussein Obama. And you know, to be honest with you, we didn't trust that cat at first. We didn't know, was he black enough or what? Who is this guy with the funny Muslim name? So Barack Obama went down to Iowa. He won the Iowa caucus, right? Then he went to New Hampshire and almost beat our darling, Hillary. You know why she was our darling? Because she was married to the first African-American president. You know how he became the first African-American president? He showed up one night when he was running for president on a black fella's nighttime talk show, TV show, called Arsenio Hall. He put on some dark shades and took out a saxophone, and he played, and we said, he is an African-American. See how shallow we are as a people. And that's why we love Hillary. But however, this new cat on the block, he goes to Iowa. Now, what, there's eight black people in Iowa? Buddy? Yeah, buddy. New Hampshire has what, 15? Well, 14 now because I moved out of New York. Actually, I moved out. So it's 14 black people in Iowa. So what are we saying here? The white people said in this country, the white Democrats, who are the people who held us in chattel slavery for 245 years, who put laws of racial segregation on us, these people. Well, these cats, these Democrats, told the blacks, he's black enough for us, he's black enough for you. And you know what we did? We went for him. We slapped Dr. King in the face, because I would tell you, 99%, I would think 99% of the black folks who voted for Barack Obama did it, not because of his ideals or content of his character, but because of the color of his skin. We danced on Dr. King's grave the night that Obama won the election. I saw gangsters in South Central Los Angeles, hard-nosed, pants-sagging gangsters
jumping up and down the middle of Crenshaw Boulevard, singing like girls, Obama, Obama. You know, yeah, we laughed, but it's funny, but it was so sad. We jumped and danced on Dr. King. And we wonder why our God has not blessed us, my people. And we're getting worse. We thought, well, we'll give them a black president. Maybe that'll make them feel proud enough to get up and do something for themselves. That just made us worse, folks. Now, I want to tell you something. This race issue, it's not so much racial. There's some race in it, but it's about the experience of two American people. One people came on the Mayflower, willingly wanting to do something, succeed or fail for their generations yet to come. The other people came on what we call the Treasure and the White Line. These were slave ships that brought these slaves to Jamestown. Two different experiences of America. Now, in most people's minds, particularly my folks' minds, and all these young people you see out there screaming, Black Lives Matter! We have this imagery that the Portuguese and the Spaniards, followed by the British and the rest of the Europeans, the white Christians and Jews, invaded the continent of Africa, ran down the Africans of the various tribes and ethnic groups and nations, captured us, marched us to the slave forts, put us on the slave ships, and brought us to the Americas. By the way, did you know that only 94% of the black cargo, human cargo, that came out of Africa went to Mexico, Central America, and South America? Okay? Only 6% came to the continental United States with colonies. Only 6%. And I'm going to tell you a story that in a minute, what you guys did about that 6%. But the fact of the matter is, folks, that's a lie. That's a lie. The Europeans, the white man, did not invade Africa. Can you imagine some white dude running down a brother in his own neighborhood? It ain't gonna happen. Just like I'm not gonna go to Appalachia and run down some white guy. But some white guy go run him down, bring him to me. And that's why, if you wonder why, when you try to have a dialogue with the African-American leaders, you can't get nowhere with them. Because they're coming from the premises that you are absolutely wrong and there's nothing you can do that's right. And because you've been taken hostage and you have been politically correct gagged, you can't say nothing, or you can also be a racist. And consequently, you got Barack Obama, who is not just tearing up our country, he's tearing up the whole world. And no one can touch him. Why? Because of the color of his skin. And I'm here tonight to empower you, to help you to break through that and be the Americans that you're supposed to be, for the sake of not only our country, but for the world. The fact of the matter is, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, when the Europeans came to the shores of Africa, they bought people who were already slaves. I come from a slave culture. That's who we are. We were enslaving each other for hundreds and thousands of years before any white folks even came to Africa. And by the way, the Muslims, very much involved in it. From 700 AD to 1400 AD, they sent, the scholars tell us, they sent anywhere from 18 million of these African different ethnic nations into the Middle East. 70% of the human cargo died in the Sahara Desert. Muslims. And then in 1400 AD to the present day, they're still enslaving our people. But from 1400, they began to send, I think it's like 12 to 13 million of us into the Americas. Muslims. But people won't say that. They won't say that because it's politically incorrect to say Muslims did that to us. If I have my way, God willing, when this message finally gets to them brothers in jail trying to be Muslims
And when they wake up and realize what them Muslims and Arabs have done to us, every Muslim and Arab in this country is going to have to leave fast as they possibly can. Because the brothers are going to be upset. Now, knowing that, see, Dr. Martin Luther King said in 1963, I have a dream that one day the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will sit together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream. Well, whenever we try to sit at the table of brotherhood, here we come pointing the finger at you. Now, God willing, and with your help and your support, we'll create a narrative where this time we sit down at the table and no longer point the finger at you, but point the finger at ourselves. In fact, we will thank you. We will thank you for what you did for us. What did you do for us? You did something that no other people in all of human history has ever done. You, white people, my brothers and sisters, you had a war. The greatest, most destructive war in the history of our nation. More American boys died in that war than all the wars this country fought combined. We say World War II was the greatest nation. All due respect to all veterans. By the way, veterans, thank you for your service. I'm sorry, my brothers. It got away from me. Thank you for your service. Fought World War II, we say that was the greatest generation. I'm sorry it wasn't. It was a great generation, no question about it. Perhaps the greatest generation in the 20th century, no question about that. But the greatest generation of all time and forever always will be, as long as this nation shall not perish from the earth, is those boys who fought that Civil War. Eric Johnson and I have created a website to kind of bolster this and emphasize this. He's the technician building the computer site. Eric is brilliant. I just added some content. You know, you can have all the message in the world you want, but if you can't get it to the marketplace, it's no one's going to hear it. And Eric has done a great work in helping us get this prepared. It's called, go to www.the740,000.com. The740,000.com. What that is saying is 740,000 innocent, young, innocent, white boys, and literally boys now. I'm not talking about you white boy. I'm talking about boys, teens, young men, bled, suffered, and died that black lives might matter. Did you hear me? 740,000 innocent young white boys and men died that black lives might matter. It was because, I'm talking not just the northern boys now, I'm talking the southern boys. In fact, in the website, you'll see where we have dedicated a special portion to the Confederate boys. And all this, and I don't know how you feel about the flag thing, but I'll go on record, you know, I could care less. That is their symbol. They were fighting from their heart as patriots. They had nothing to do with slavery, the North or the Southern boys. Yet they had to pay the price of our founding fathers kicking the can down the road. I'm not knocking them. They didn't know what else to do, because remember, the United States did not start and initiate chattel slavery. The British Empire did. We were under their jurisdiction. There was no United States. It's just that when the United States came into existence, we were transferred from the jurisdiction of the English crown into the jurisdiction of the United States of America. No, it is not your fault, but we are responsible to rectify it. Obviously, because those poor boys in the Civil War had to pay that price. And out of that came the 13th, the 14th, the 15th Amendment, the Civil Rights Act of 1866. You know, we say, you know, that the, and also the anti-Ku Klux Klan laws, we say that, you know, the Civil Rights legacy
That's black people's legacy, man. Civil rights, that's black people's legacy. That's not true either, my brothers and sisters. That is not true, and we got to stop that. The civil rights legacy is yours. You were the abolitionist. You're the ones who shed your blood. Of course, 38,000 black guys also died in the war, too. But you are the ones. You wrote the Civil Rights Act. You wrote the 13th and 14th Amendment. You did this. This is your legacy, something that you need to take pride in. No other people in the history of the world has done what you have done. We, the freed chattel slaves, the descendants of them, are the beneficiaries of your legacy. That's where we see, we've got it all mixed up. We didn't start the civil rights movement. Y'all did. This is your legacy. Now, you gave us something we Africans never had in Africa. We lived under monarchs. We knew nothing of freedom of speech, nothing of liberty, nothing of freedom, nothing of that. We were property of the kings. And we dare not think creatively. We dare not think outside of the box, because if we thought too much about it, we'll blurt it out and the king will cut our heads off. That's how tyranny suppresses creative thought. And we didn't have creative thought. When we got here, we became creative. We watched you. We watched your beliefs. We learned from you. We had all these different languages. We got one single language now, English. You know, we've never, ever, as a people, since we've been set free from slavery, we've always marched, we've always complained, we've always criticized. You've done nothing. You need to do more. You did this to this. You shouldn't have done that. There's always criticism. There has never, and God willing, if he gives me the platform with your help, I'm going to organize one day, a whole week, annual, whatever, whereby we will march, hold vigils, demonstrations, rallies, parades, saying, thank you, white man. Thank you, white people. Thank you. We've never once said thank you. Have you heard of anybody ever saying that to you? All you've ever got was criticism. You can't do enough. Thank you. You gave us, you ended slavery. Then you did something really fantastic. You gave us the Civil Rights Act of 1866 because you realized, yes, these people are free from slavery, but who are they? What are they? We better make them citizens. So he wrote the Civil Rights Act of 1866. It has 10 sections in it. And in that Civil Rights Act, they said that, let me read it to you. Being enacted by the Senate and the House of Representatives of the United States of America and Congress assembled, that all persons born in the United States and are not subject to any foreign power, excluding Indians not taxed, or are hereby declared to be citizens of the United States, and such citizens of every race and color without regard to any previous condition of slavery or involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall have the same right in every state and territory in the United States to make and enforce contracts, to sue, be parties, give evidence, to inherit, purchase, lease, sell, hold, and convey real and personal property, and to full and equal benefit of all laws and proceedings for the security of person and property as is enjoyed by white citizens, and shall be subject to like punishment, pains, and penalties, and to none other any law, statute, ordinance, regulation, or custom to the contrary notwithstanding. And it has 10 sections total, 9 that enforces Section 1. And here's something very interesting, and I believe, I can't go into detail about this, but if you go to, here's another website for you, if you go to the CHNC, .us, the CHNC.us, that's the Capitol Hill National Caucus. Go there, scroll down, and you'll see something called the POTUS is arrestable.
The President of the United States is arrested. And I explained why impeachment will never work. But I explained how we, the people, can actually put him in jail tomorrow. Okay? Section 2 says, and be it further enacted, that any person who under the color of any law, statute, ordinance, regulation, or custom shall subject or cause to be subjected any inhabitant of any state or territory to the deprivation of any rights secured or protected by this act, or to different punishments, pains, or penalties on account of such person having at any time been held in a condition of slavery or involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, or by reason of his race or color, than is prescribed for the punishment of white persons, shall be deemed guilty of a misdemeanor, and on conviction shall be punished by fine not exceeding $1,000, or imprisonment not exceeding 1 year, or both in the discretion of the court. Barack Hussein Obama has violated this. They say, and he supports this, they say that when a child is born to a woman without permission in this country, legal permission in this country, that child, based on the 14th Amendment, Section 1, is a U.S. citizen. That's bull, you know what? Let me read it. Now, this is very similar to this and this. All persons born and naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of that state wherein they reside. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. One and same. Now, I learned from John Eastman, as I began to study this on my own and got a chance to meet him, somebody said, man, you need to talk to John Eastman. So we called John Eastman, had a conversation, and he pointed out that when the Republican architects wrote the Civil Rights Act of 1866 to give us our citizenship, they realized, wait a minute, hold up. Some Congress down the road one day can pass another act to repeal this act. There is no security for this thing. So what they did was they said, we need to codify this into the Constitution of the United States, make it very difficult for anyone to repeal this. Hence the 14th Amendment. See, what I learned from this, you cannot separate the 14th Amendment from the Civil Rights Act of 1866. Now, I know the La Raza scholars are aware of this. I know the president, the POTUS, is aware of this. And a lot of other people are aware of this. But most of us in this country are not aware of this. Without a lack of knowledge, my people are destroyed. I see, the way I look at this piece, the 14th Amendment, the Civil Rights Act of 1866, y'all, is the body, the bones, the internal organs, the sinews, the muscles. This is the body. The 14th Amendment is the skin on the body. If you strip the 14th Amendment and give it to illegal alien babies, you strip the body. And the body without skin will die. See, when I first got involved with the fight against illegal immigration. We realize that, yes, it hurts every American U.S. citizen. It hurts us all. It hurts everything. But we come to realize they were coming after us, because they knew if they could take us down and get rid of us, they would have carte blanche to destroy you. And they've done a pretty good job. Let me tell you how they did it. Okay, you say, my white brothers, you say, Senator Pierce says, hey, SB 1070, you can't come into my country without proper, you're supposed to go to Article 1, Section 8, and that is your way into the country as an immigrant. You can't do this. And they say, well, you're a racist. And Pierce says, what? How in the world can I be a racist? Listen, if I come into your house without permission, I'm a criminal, right? Yeah. Well, what makes you think you can come into my house and just do whatever you want to. Aren't you? Oh, no, sir, you're a racist. How am I racist? Look at my skin color. Look at my skin color. See, you are treating us like you treat the blacks. We are a minority. And by the way, we are the majority minority in California, so we get everything we want. And Pierce, his hands are tied. That's why they attacked him. That's why they played the race card. See? That's why the Muslims, he said, hey, Muhammad, you can't put loudspeakers up on the street corners and brag up five times a day. Well, Allah, Allah, you can't do that. That's not right. You're disturbing the Christians and Jews and everybody else. You can't do that. You're a racist. Muhammad, why am I racist? Look at my skin color. I'm a minority. Dude. Same thing with the homosexual community. They jumped on the 14th Amendment too. You're treating us like you treat the blacks. And what do, my brothers and sisters? Y'all, the rulers of this country, you go, okay, that's how they got this far. They have used what Abraham Lincoln called the house divided against itself. It was over the issue of chattel slavery. We never got it fixed, folks. Abraham Lincoln warned us at Gettysburg. He said, now, what these boys have done here, what they've advanced our cause nobly so far. He says, but we must now be dedicated to the unfinished work that these dead have provided for us. He said that we must finish this. If we don't, we will perish from the earth. And for various reasons, we didn't finish it. But I believe in the wisdom of God, we're going to finish it in this generation. We're going to finish it in this generation. And what I want to share with you, as you understand this, what I become to you, while I am the weakness of you, because they're coming through me to get to you. Oh, by the way, you know what they say to y'all? You European white people, you're all old. You're not having babies. You're going to all die off. Or they say, you white Europeans, go back to Europe and take your niggers with you. Oh, did I say a bad word? Oh, excuse me. The N-word's with you. Speaking of the N-word, I grew up in Jim Crow, Maryland, in Alabama. Throughout my life, I was called a nigger, whatever, and with viciousness and malice, I would say about 15 times. There was one group of kids, white kids we used to play with in the community, and we'd be playing baseball or marbles or whatever. We play every day, right? And we may get the best of them or whatever, and make me argue, and they would get from here to maybe to that wall, okay? And they would go, nigger, they take, I mean, we running after those guys, come back here, and they go home. Guess what? The next day, we're out there hugging and playing and drinking out of the same soda bottle. When we had a march in downtown Los Angeles with Jim Gilchrist, Barbara Cole, the Minutemen, and boy, we black folks, white folks, Latinos, we all together, and we marched through what we call Little Mexico Broadway. We're going, USA, USA. I was called a nigger with viciousness at least 80 to 100 times. Mexicans, Latinos, Hispanics, illegal aliens, put it that way. And they called her, and Gabby, they called Hispanic, Latino, Mexican, U.S. citizens, Tio Tacos, carried on. You know all the words. They call white folks hunkies and crackers. And they say that because we say you cannot come across that border illegally. That's hate speech. It offends me. We've got to get to the point, my American brothers and sisters, where we say, okay, yeah, it offends you. Call it hate speech. But you're going to get the hell out of my country right now. right now. And the rest of you, don't even think about coming here. And they say, why? Because 740,000 innocent young white boys and men suffered, bled, and died for the matter of these blacks here that you are destroying or seeking to destroy. And we're not going to allow you to do that anymore. And brothers and sisters, you don't have to know everything about black history and about all the black jive and this, that, and the other, and all the black. You ain't got to know all that stuff. All you got to know is that you are the guardians of some young men who died, suffered. Not just died, they suffered. I got to be careful. I got to stay focused. I've watched these documentaries on the Civil War. And what they and their families had to endure. It was horrible. See, the outcome of that war with them boys, that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion for, that is not finished. The outcome is not finished. And if we allow this invasion, it's not illegal immigration, this is a civilian, a non-militaristic stealth invasion and occupation of the United States. It's a war. Okay. If we allow that to stand, if we allow them to continue to claim this, my birth certificate, which them boys died that I may have, that I may be a citizen that enjoys the bounties of America as is enjoyed by white citizens. If we allow that colored fella in the White House and his social minions to continue to rob our country and the Muslims to rob our country, my brothers and sisters, when the United States is over, guess what? You and I will be held accountable because it happened on our watch. You can say, well, it's not fair. That's not fair. We had nothing to do with that. That's irrelevant. You have inherited it. And you see, I believe that we are twins, paternal twins as a people. But we are conjoined together. God played a trick on us. He brought y'all from the Mayflower over here, brought us on the treasure and the white lion over here, and he stuck us together. And whether we like it or not, like each other or not, is irrelevant, because in his sight, we share the same internal vital organs. You die, I die. I die, you die. We are stuck together. Like it or not. So we better try to like it. Adapt to it. And we find when we get to know each other, we do like each other. We do like each other. And we do love each other. We've allowed people to separate us. So, by the way, I don't mean to be hard on you. If you think I'm hard on you, but it's like this. I'm saying, come on, white dude. Snap out of it. Snap out of it. If you die, I'm selfish. I want to live, y'all. So please live. And we want to help you to do this. What I'm sharing with you, when a person goes to battle, they have a shield and a sword to fight. And they can fight with confidence because they have a defense. My brothers and sisters, patriots, you don't have any defense. You don't have a shield. You got a sword. You are so right with the law. And the liberals, the Democrats, the illegal aliens, the Muslims, the homosexual community, all of them know that you are right by the law. And you can out-argue them every time, as Senator Pierce pointed out. Every time, they know that. But they beat you because they bring in the emotion, skin color. They take your legacy, civil rights, and turn it against you. Take your own sword, your own constitution, and turn it against you.
deny you the First Amendment, freedom of speech, freedom of thought. You see, because you don't have a shield, and maybe now, because we're on the verge of destruction, maybe now we're going to get it together. I, this weakness, am now your strength. I am your shield. I am your black shield. And what you're supposed to do is you, by supporting what I'm saying and doing, we're getting together here, what you're doing is you're picking up that black shield. And you're putting that shield out in front of you. And you got the sword, the sharp sword of the Constitution of the United States. And now you have protection, because when you wield that sword, you're wielding it because they are destroying or trying to destroy what? But those 740,000 young, innocent white boys suffered, perished, shed their blood, and died for the matter of these black lives. So when you say, no, you can't cross the border. Why? Because you're destroying this. Birthright citizenship. No, it belongs to these. No, Muslim. You pull that black shield up. How are they going to call you racist, really, when you are defending us? They can't. And when you do that, black folks all across this country are going to come to you. They're going to wake up and say, dug it, the Republicans have come home. Don't misunderstand, Republicanism and conservatism are not the same thing. Those are two different things. Some dudes in L.A. threatened my life, because I'm Republican. Now, by the way, I quit the Republican Party. I joined 2003. I thought I'd come home, but anyway, I quit. But I am still a Republican of 1854 and 1856. That's who I am. That's who you are. If you're Republican. Say, oh, Douglas Republican, whatever. If you're a Republican. When that happens, my people are coming home. We don't care what color you are. We really don't. That racist thing about, no, there's a few knuckleheads out there. But we don't care what color you are if you're defending us. And you do this, you'll be able to wield the sword of the law with impunity. And we will win our country back. The last time that our country was on the verge of destruction was 150 years ago. Abraham Lincoln finally came to realize God, Declaration of Independence guy, wanted this stain on his name and this country to be removed. And that's why in 1863, January 1st, after issuing the warning in September 22nd, 1862, the Emancipation Proclamation. When that happened, even though the war continued longer, that was the death knell of chattel slavery in this country. God had blessed us, saved the Union. Now, we didn't finish the second part. We finished the first part. We freed the slaves. We ended it. But we didn't finish the second part. And this has been the controversy ever since. Now, the controversy has raged on the one side because my people have never had a leader to say the things I'm saying to you right now. I'm going to tell you something. All your conservative African American, black, colored, Negro, conservative, Republican Tea Party men and women, they have not served you well. They have not served you well. They don't talk like this. They will not talk like this. The most they may do is put down how stupid black people are and how we have babies, we're struggling on drugs, we're gangbangers, and we're well-fared. We need to get off the Democrat plantation. We heard that from Bill Cosby. But you don't hear, well, what do we do about it? My white brothers and sisters, they come to you. I'm not knocking, I'm just telling you these are facts. They come to you and they try to tell you, well, I'm a conservative. And they'll spend all this time telling you how conservative they are and how conservative you are and what it means to be conservative. My white brothers and sisters do not need to hear about conservatism. That's a problem. My apologies. I'm sorry. I've got a... white people You do not need to hear from black people about conservatism. Y'all taught us conservatism. You need to hear from us how we together can rectify the situation, close up that wound, and drive the invader out of our country. That's what you need to hear from us. You can't fix us because you did not break us. We were broken by ourselves in Africa. We were already sick. We were already messed up. So you can't fix that. You wonder why the more you give, the more you do, the worse we get? Because you can't fix us. Only we can fix us. We have got to become honest with ourselves before our God that we have walked in rebellion to him. Then when you offer, he will bless that offering and we can do something with it. Because every time you do something, God destroys it. Because we have not yet repented ourselves. And see, you take, for example, the 14th Amendment. I know we all love Ben Carson, but he should own this. If he owned this, Trump would be knocked out of the box. The only thing that keeps Trump alive is this 14th Amendment issue, immigration issue. He'd been gone. Personally, I could care less about Donald Trump. I could care freaking less about that guy. He's an entertainer, whatever, rich guy. But when he said, I'm running for the president, we're having a news conference, and when he said this stuff, I said, say what? Wow. In the second debate, remember Jake Tapper said, 14th Amendment, Donald Trump, he went like this. I remember him raising his hand, he banged down, he says, your guys are wrong because my guys tell me that I'm right, that it's not for these anchor children. But he didn't go further. Then way down on the end of the stage, Rand Paul said, now Senator Pierce and I and John Eastman had talked about this the night before because we were going to make, because what we've created this collaborative where we want to meet with Mr. Trump and anybody else privately to discuss this thing because we feel that if Mr. Trump does not fully understand the fullness of the 14th Amendment, the birthright citizenship, that he could make it worse for us and thereby put the country in greater trouble. So we want to meet with him privately to make sure he knows what he's talking about. Now, if he's not being open about it now because he's playing a Trump card, they're going to wait close to the election and say, it's four. Okay, that's fine. And we'll say, cool, Mr. Trump, have at it. But we need to know. We have responsibility to know this, right? So anyway, Trump says, you guys are wrong. Rand Paul says it. He says, the 14th Amendment was for the freed slaves. Jake Tapper, and he didn't elaborate, but Jake Tapper quickly changed the subject as though someone lit a stick of dynamite, and they ran. Our beloved Ben Carson stood there, didn't say one word. I'm not knocking him. I think I know why he didn't, but he said nothing. I talked to our beloved...